What's going on, everybody? Hope you're all well. We're talking Norway today, who will be selecting their song and artist to represent them at Eurovision through a new version of MGP. Lots of changes this year. No more pre-qualified artists. Everybody had to earn their spot in the final. No more duels, golden duels, super duper duels, whatever they were. And finally, we see the return of juries in this year's final. And that means that we might be seeing a very different winner to the ones that we've seen in the last few years. So let's talk about who that might be. I always feel like these reviews are more fun when I don't have to do them alone, so I invited a friend with me to talk about MGP's 9 finalists, Mandy from ESC Norge, and I started by asking her what she thinks of the changes for MGP this year.
You know, I've been enjoying it much more, both as a viewer and also like a super fan. To have 7 songs each week has been so much better than just the 4. Also, I think the flow of the show, when you don't have these duels where you need to stop and start and vote in between, it's been running much more smoothly this year. So it's easier to watch, it's easier to vote. Everything's just much more easy, more brutal as well with just one vote. It's really difficult to pick just one song because I think it's been a good MGP year overall with the quality of songs. So brutal and simple and fun.
It seems to have also gone down well internationally, which is good because MGP has often been a show that attracts a lot of attention from international fans. And speaking of attention, there is a certain returning artist here who a lot of people have been hoping would return to MGP after winning in 2020. That, of course, was the year where Eurovision was canceled for the first time ever. And that is, of course, where we're going to be starting. Honestly, there were high expectations for Ulrikke going into Eurovision 2020. Her song Attention was among the many fan favorites that there were that year. And because we never got to see how that would play out at Eurovision, there is a bit of a redemption arc with her participation this time around. And the song that she's bringing this time actually draws inspiration from what was going on around the time of Eurovision's cancellation.
The story is about her life with her manager. They lived together during this storm, I would call it. And as if it wasn't tough enough to have one of your greatest chances of music exposure out in Europe, at the same time, your best friend's father passes away with cancer. And that was the day after the cancellation of Eurovision. Her manager, Christopher, wanted to work through it and just, you know, be quiet and focus on work. And Ulrikke herself, being a very loving, touching person, needing to talk things through, they just ended up not talking at all. It was in the midst of all of this that she realized that, oh my God, I'm losing my best friend and my manager. We can't even be in the same room and talk together anymore. Eventually, everything worked out okay with them. They found each other again. But the story behind the song is, you know, when that moment when you realize, oh my God, I'm gonna lose you.
The story has certainly struck an emotional chord with lots of people, and I think that's pretty clear to see by how many people really want her to represent Norway again and get that opportunity that was taken away from her in 2020. But there has been some discussion about the song itself and how much it stands on its own with the context removed.
A lot of people say that it's predictable, but I don't think it is. The chorus is very familiar in a way. It's very timeless, but it keeps you on your toes. And I think that's important when you're going to Eurovision, that it's not too predictable.
Another thing that I've seen a lot, and I don't know how much you've seen it, is the comparison to Husavik. I think there's kind of two sides of that, because obviously, like, Husavik is a great song, but there is also the side of it where it was kind of trying to take all the boxes for a Eurovision ballad, for like all the familiar aesthetic choices. What do you think of that? Do you think that that's perhaps a negative quality, or do you see it differently?
It's very hard to tell, because for me personally, it's okay, because I know that the reason it's made this way is because they want it so badly. It's not done in a lazy way. I do get what people are saying, but at the same time, I kind of disagree. Mm-hmm. Maybe I'm a bit biased.
It seems that this is the aspect where a lot of people are split. And honestly, I put myself in the latter category, where I do see the song for the kind of safe qualities, the very familiar qualities, to put it that way. But that's also considering that I'm pretty deep into the world of Eurovision right now. And while I might be more attracted by songs that are more inventive, that doesn't mean that everyone else is that picky. For that reason, I don't think that the song should be discounted for the rest of the qualities that it has, because ultimately, we have a very talented singer here with a heartfelt performance and a melody that's pretty catchy, even if it is a bit familiar, as Mandy puts it. Alessandra is bringing one of the most energetic songs in this year's final. It is actually going to be closing the show. It's also getting a lot of love and attention, even having a bit of a viral moment on TikTok. And although this song is finishing second to Ulrikke in most polls, according to Mandy, there have been some others where she actually comes out on top. And it seems that for people who are kind of like me and are not 100% sold on Ulrikke's song, this one seems to be the most likely to grab their attention.
She's a storm, isn't she? She came out of nowhere and she took us all by surprise. And I'm here for it. She's very tough. She wants to go out there and show off her skills and you know what she stands for. She's very open-minded and all for equality. And I think this song shows that in her, both the lyrics and also her when she's performing the song.
Now, putting all the praise aside, I do see some people writing this entry off as another one of those like yassified bops that we tend to see with Eurovision. On paper, it definitely seems that way, but I actually think that this has got a lot more going on. Rather than go for the more typical radio dance pop style, this one actually leans much more into like an EDM festival sound. And it gives the song a unique energy, which helps it be impactful. The way that she sings it, I think, also helps it stand out, because instead of going for the softer, more sultry, seductive voice that those yassified songs tend to go for, this one conveys power. In fact, there doesn't even really seem to be much of a need to depend on sex appeal, which I think is a pretty big accomplishment, because a lot of those yassified bops lean into that so much to the point where it's a bit ridiculous. There is one thing to mention, however, about the live performance, and that has to do with a more controversial rule that's been introduced in this year's MGP, which is the allowance of autotune.
I think she uses autotune. I have to say think, because I don't really know. For me personally, I have such strong convictions about the use of autotune, so I think that her going to Eurovision based on using autotune in MGP is a bit risky, because she's a very new artist, very young, but at the same time, I know she knows how to sing live. Maybe she just needs stronger backing vocals. Maybe she needs to dance a little less and it'll be fine. It would be a great song for Eurovision. I mean, everybody would be at Euroclub digging to the song. So yeah, I'm positive. I mean, I wouldn't have anything against it going to Eurovision for Norway.
Umami Tsunami are this year's youngest artists, being 16, 17, and 20. And the song that they're bringing is also targeting a younger crowd. It definitely seems to be tapping into the popularity of K-pop.
I love that, you know, we have some current songs that it's very 2023. Although they're very young, they have a lot of experience already, and they're talented guys. They've grabbed this opportunity with both hands. They're doing everything they can to get attention around the song. They're making, I don't know how many, was it 5 or 8 different remixes? They're doing everything, yeah. So, very impressive, and such great guys.
But realistically, how likely do you think this is to win or to get a good result?
I do believe that there's use of autotune, and also Christian's voice cracked a bit. And I think with the juries, it's going to be even more important that you are delivering the best vocals that you have. And that's hard when you're dancing and moving like these guys are. At the same time, with K-pop being so current and in the wind right now, they might gain some extra support, especially among younger viewers, I think.
For all the things that we discussed about market appeal, I think it makes sense that a song like this is in the final. As far as whether or not this would or should be chosen to go to Eurovision, personally, I don't think so. I think that these performers are still quite green, and the first step should be to find their footing before being put on an international stage like Eurovision. But at the very least, it's great for these kinds of young artists to have these platforms like MGP, and although the show is ultimately choosing the country's Eurovision entry, it should also serve as an opportunity for viewers to find these up-and-coming artists. So I think that they can still benefit tremendously from being in the show. So why do we do it?
What good will it ruin when holding my tongue will for sure mean goodbye?
Elsie Bay is a returning face that many people will recognize. She participated in last year's MGP with the song Death of Us, which was both a fan favorite and got itself into the top four. With her return, she's bringing a similar style of song, which has this kind of lush orchestration and a very solemn story at the center of it. It was a combo that worked for her last year, and this year it also seems to be working quite well.
I would say it's so much more alive than Death of Us. Okay, pardon the pun, but with the piano in the background, the way the song just lives on its own with the instrumental, it's such a beautiful song, and she knows that she needed to nail the staging this time for everybody to, you know, be supportive of her and see that this is a Eurovision act. I do think that the fan base is very happy with her returning with this quality piece of music and a quality performance, but I am also afraid that with the 9 songs that we have in the final now, that this is gonna be a little bit anonymous. You know, when you're a family watching Eurovision or a Melodi Grand Prix final with 9 songs, I'm not sure that she's gonna be the one who sticks out the most to get that one vote.
Now that we're at the final, I would say that I agree that it does seem like among these 9 songs, her song is not standing out quite as much as it did when we were looking at all the semi-finalists. But with that said, there's definitely some notable achievements here, because last year she had that direct pass to the final and got to the top 4. This year she had to start at the same level as everyone else and still made it to the final. She's also established herself as a songwriter, having other entries in MGP in years past, and even in this year, another one of her songs is in the final. So even if she doesn't get the victory, she's clearly not leaving this show empty-handed. Jone is bringing another one of this selection's most energetic songs, and much like Queen of the Kings, this one also leans a bit into an EDM festival sound. In fact, I would say more so than Queen of the Kings. It's also the only entry in this year's final that's completely in Norwegian, which for international fans is often a plus. Interestingly, for Norwegians on the other hand, there's this idea about the musical scene that this song represents, and that's actually turning certain people off.
Well, we call them party songs, very negatively charged. It's more like trash party music. And this one, I think, is mistaken for that by a lot of people, because this is actually a love song. He plays the part, and I believe him when he sings that, you know, this woman, she lives inside of me like an echo, and I don't know what to do about it. Like, was it something I did wrong? I do believe him, and that's so important when you're gonna try to have this party anthem in MGP. We've seen time and time again that party songs can do well, but they normally just, they stop outside top 4. Sometimes they reach top 2, but they normally never win. But when it's a party song about love, everybody can relate to that. I mean, come on. Mm-hmm.
Personally, I find the song to be quite enjoyable, but I would say that the biggest weakness is its staging. It just seems quite a bit less polished than the rest of the songs. There was an observation as well that was made about the fact that the female singer who performs the hook is not there, and she's kind of put in the song as an overlay. That does actually fit the context of the song, so it is justified, but perhaps it's not being done in the most natural way, and it's just feeling a little bit too produced and is clashing with everything else. Ultimately, I do think that there are a few things holding this entry back, but I mean, this kind of trashy music is popular for a reason, so maybe the fans of that music will all rally behind this, and this could go further than other people realize. MGP seems to have this habit of bringing these entries that reference the early 20th century and using like vaudeville, cabaret kind of aesthetics. This is the song that is fitting that niche for this year. And because of that, when I heard it before the show, I wasn't really expecting much, because in the past, those songs haven't gone very far. Of course, here we are, it's in the final, and it seems that it was a pleasant surprise for a lot of people.
When I watched the rehearsal for this, I said, you know what, this can actually qualify. This is a quality entry. These are musicians on stage delivering their own product. They believe in this. This is what they do. They didn't just make this song for MTP. This is their product. They're so like strict with, I'm not going to use autotune in MTP. That's everything that we stand against. We want to be, you know, real musicians telling our story and our message. We don't want to mess it up with, you know, all these things that aren't allowed. They're very pure guys.
It's definitely a fun performance. And one thing that I think it does successfully when compared to some of the other performances is that it gives you enough variation over the course of the 3 minutes to keep you engaged. Things like alternating between the two singers, having two of the band members break out into dance, moments like when this guy climbs his bass. It just keeps giving you reasons to stay glued to the screen. As far as how this is going to go down in the final, I am still a bit reluctant to think that this is going to make a big dent in the score. But again, it is a new year for MGP and we've seen surprises all throughout this year. It's a strong performance, it's got lots of visual engagement, so it could actually do a lot better than people are expecting. Another thing about MGP is that it has this openness to camp that's greater than your average Eurovision selection. And I think that Skrellex's song is a perfect example of that. The reception of the song when it was released was not all that great. In fact, it ranked quite low on a lot of polls, but it seems that a lot of people were really won over by the performance. For myself, I found it to be a pretty ordinary drag performance that didn't really give me anything new. But there is actually another layer here that further explains its appeal to the Norwegian public.
The video, the introduction with him talking about, you know, being closed down for 2 to 3 years because of Corona, then the terrorism in Norway this summer against this gay bar in Oslo. When she sings about, you know, taking back our lives and, you know, let's love again, just be free to be who we want to be, let us just party and have a good time. And I think that's what everybody wants after these years of COVID and lockdown and, you know, with wars and everything miserable. It was heartwarming, all of it. And I think that we needed this act in the final. And I'm so happy that Skrellex is there.
So with that in mind, I think this is a pretty deserved qualification, even if it's not really doing anything new visually or musically. I still don't necessarily think that this would ever be chosen as the winner or do very well in the score. But at the very least, it could be a moment where all of Trondheim Spectrum is turned into a massive gay bar. And given the tragedy of last year, that's such a wonderful way to bring people together and celebrate.
I blocked your number cause there's one name I just cannot see. Oh darling, I lied to say you can't want to.
One criticism that I've had of MGPs in the past, and I know I'm not the only one, is that the majority of the songs tend to feel very gimmicky when they're performed on stage. And it was a bit frustrating because I felt like there were a number of songs that were well performed, had good songwriting behind them, but they were passed on simply because they didn't overdo it. And that's what I was thinking of when Eline took to the stage with a very straightforward band performance that didn't have any extra things going on. It seems that we can now say that you can show up to MGP with a less is more approach and make it through on televote, which gives me a lot of faith about the future.
Eline became superstar on that stage. I don't know why she's been away for 8 years with stage fright. I don't know what she's been missing, but my God, that girl, she owned that stage. Vocally, she was on point. She looked the part, she dressed the part. It was, you know, it wasn't packaged into this typical MGP act. It was a live show, and I really think that people appreciated that last night.
I feel like this song, with the kind of authentic feel that it has, and also having a pretty effective hook and being well performed, I would feel like this could certainly get jury support. Do you think that's possible from your point of view?
Yeah, definitely. And I do think that once you add the instrumental, you know, with the band and the live feel, I think that's something the juries might like even more than an Elsie Bay ballad, sort of.
A different Elsie Bay ballad, though, right? Because this one is also hers. With regards to how far this could actually go and whether or not it could win, I still don't really see this being a televote heavyweight, and so it's probably going to be depending more on jury score. But considering that so few performances like this actually make it to this point, maybe now is the opportunity for all of us to be proven wrong. And if I'm being honest, I do think this would actually be a good choice for Liverpool, if that can happen.
I'm full of water. Yeah.
Fans will recognize Atle from NGP 2021, where he participated with what I still think to this day is the most Melodi Festivalen looking and sounding song that I've ever seen outside of Melodi Festivalen. Kind of like a Eric Sade at home kind of thing.
Eric Sade Day.
For that reason, this song was not at all on my radar until I saw it being performed live. Visually, it's well crafted. He performed it with a lot of emotion, and it's the song that stuck with me the most. I don't even have to listen to it and it comes back to me. So now it's very much on my radar, and I'm actually considering this as a possible winner. Mandy, on the other hand, is not as enthusiastic, but it led to a very interesting discussion.
I don't feel it. Like, I'm not a fan of songs that sound very Melodi Festival-like. Although I know that this is a ballad that he's pouring his heart out to his daughter and this means the world to him, I am not feeling it.
Because you said that, like, you know, you're not personally a fan of songs that sound like they're from Melfest. Do you think that other people would be able to pick up on something like that, where they would watch something and they'd be like, no, this is too Swedish for me?
In Norway, we have this thing called Janteloven, and it's like a law that says something like, you shouldn't stand out, you don't think that you're better than anyone. And the thing about when we say it's too Swedish, it's not necessarily Melodi Festivalen, it's just that it's polished. You know, he looks the part, he's very flashy, although he's not flashy, you know, it's all very perfected in a way. And in Norway, we like things a bit more, you know, down to earth and a bit scruffy. Is that a way to say it?
rough around the edges.
Yeah. I think that will be the one thing that could slip him up. But like I said, he has a big fan base. He's very, very well liked in Norway. So he could be the outsider or underdog to grab the victory on Saturday.
So now that we've discussed all 9 finalists, we of course have to choose a winner. And so I asked Mandy who she thought could take Norway the furthest when it comes to Eurovision.
I have to say from the bottom of my heart, I do believe that any of the songs that we send to Eurovision, I can get behind. There's not one act that I'm thinking, oh no, I don't want this to represent Norway, which is a, you know, relief in itself. But my personal favorite is Honestly, and I do have a few others that I could, you know, really cheer on if it's not Ulrikke going off with the victory in the end. But I know what they bring, the package and everything around it. They would go all in on this adventure, and that, you know, gives me the extra, what do you call it, the extra...
Faith?
It gives me the, yeah, no, not necessarily faith. I have extra desire to send them to Eurovision.
Okay, you have extra desire to send them to Eurovision.
Okay. isn't there like an English word for that?
Maybe, but I can't think of it now.
Thank you so much, Mandy, for all of the information that you provided. I had so much fun talking to you. And for your sake, I hope it is Ulrikke who gets chosen, because I know it would make you happy and it would also make a ton of other fans happy. She was, in fact, my choice for 2020, so I definitely wouldn't be disappointed. Now, if I had to go for my personal choice for 2023, I'm in between Alessandra, Eline, and Atle. Between the three of them, I think that Alessandra could actually get them the furthest, and I think that certain people might be underestimating this one for the kind of song that it is. I don't think it's this typical Yassified bop. I think there's a lot more going on there, and it would be really interesting to see how far this could go. Nonetheless, those are our thoughts on NGP 2023. Let us know what you have to say. Who do you want to see represent Norway this year, and who are you going to be voting for if you're from Norway? As the peak approaches of Eurovision national selection season, I am starting to think that maybe I've bitten off more than I can chew with these very detailed videos, but a lot of you have been very encouraging with your comments and your feedback. I'm so grateful that you're here and that you tell me what you think about the channel and about your favorite songs. It's just really wonderful, and I hope that you do it more because it's really encouraging. If you haven't done so already, I would love if you subscribe to the channel so that we can talk about some other selections that are coming up, as well as who is going to be winning and representing Norway when we find out on Saturday. I hope to see you on the next video, and until then, take care.